Jeremiah chapter 48 against Moab. You know, we talked about the Philistines last chapter in Tyre. Now we pick up Moab. Now this is a child of Lot against Moab. Thus saith the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel. Woe unto, you better have the God of Israel. Woe unto Nebo, cities of Moab, for it is spoiled. People have come and taken. Kiriathim is confounded and taken. No more. Misgav is confounded and dismayed. There shall be no more praise of Moab. How great they are. In Heshbon, they have devised evil against it. Come and let us cut it off from being a nation. You know, the people out there that want to get rid of them, want to destroy them. Also thou shalt be cut down, O madman. What was the capital M? The sword shall pursue thee. It's one particular person. A voice of crying shall be from Harnamim. Spoiling. That's what happens after a war. You go in and take what you want, and great destruction, as had happened in Jerusalem. Places burning, walls crumbled. Moab is destroyed. Her little ones have caused a cry to be heard. The little children are left. Parents are dead, gone, scattered, taken away. For in the going up of Lehith, continual weeping shall go up. A mountain, a hill type. For in the going down of Harim, the enemies have heard a cry of destruction. It's just destruction and misery. Destruction and misery. Flee, save your lives. That's what Lot had to do. Before Moab was conceived and born. And be like the heath in the wilderness. And that's the type of plant. And with this, you can run to Matthew 24, 16 to 21. It's just go, leave. Don't go back. Lot was told not to turn back. His wife turned back. Jesus said to the Jews, don't go back and get. Just go. For because thou hast trusted in thy works, Jews were to be trusted in their works, not Gentiles. And in thy treasures, oh, you know, look how much gold we got. Look how much the stocks we got. Look how much money we've had. Look how much investments we got. Thou shalt also be taken. And Chemosh shall go forth into captivity with his priests and his princes together. So here's a captivity. You're going to be taken by an enemy. The priests. And these are not the Levites. These are priests of false gods. That's what the priests were of the Lord that were taken. There were two prophets. There was a prophet of the Lord, and there were prophets of Baal and prophets of all the false gods. And the spoiler shall come upon every city, and no city shall escape. And the valley also shall perish, and the plain shall be destroyed, as the Lord has spoken. So utter destruction, utter desolation, nothing to be left, everywhere and anywhere. Give wings, Matthew 24:19, unto Moab, that it may flee and get away, for the cities thereof shall be desolate, without any to dwell therein. No population. Cursed be he that doeth the work of the Lord deceitfully. How's that verse? How's that verse go down behind anybody, behind a podium, behind a pulpit, behind any kind of Bible? He's talking to Moab. Written by a Jewish man. Do you know you can be saved and be cursed? If you work the work of the Lord deceitfully? It's what it is. 1 Samuel 15:1-3. We've already talked about treasures and riches. Some people enter the ministry for great fame and great money. And cursed be he that keepeth back his sword from blood. Hebrews 4:12, Psalms 149:5-7. The word of God. You better get that sword out. You better know how to use it. It's part of the armor that God's giving you. It's either going to be the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ or the blood of slain men. Talk about a war here. But the context is the war, but the application is to those that when the Lord has a work to do, you better do it rightfully. Moab has been at ease from his youth, America. Entertainment center. Movie district. Broadway. He has settled on his leave and has not been empty from vessel to vessel. Neither has he gone into captivity. Therefore, his taste remain in him and his scent is not changed. He's just sitting. He hasn't moved. And the stuff is settled down to the bottom. Hasn't been mixed. Therefore, behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will send unto him wanderers, and shall cause him to wander, and shall empty his vessels and break their bottles. It's going to cause a stir. He's going to disrupt. He's going to damage. And Moab shall be ashamed of Chemosh, as the house of Israel was ashamed of Bethel and their confidence. And remember, Bethel was the place where Jacob met the Lord and went back. But Bethel became a place of, you know, the king's residence became a place, you know, just, God wasn't there no more. How say ye, what are the mighty and strong men for the war? Moab is spoiled, gone up out of her city. His chosen young men are gone down to the slaughter, saith the King, capital K, whose name is the Lord of hosts. There's the Lord Jesus Christ speaking in Jeremiah 48. There's a war. And after the war, there is spoiling. You find that all through the Bible. Gone out of the city, that's captivities, running, captive, fleeing, slaughter, being killed. The calamity of Moab is near to come, and his affliction hasteth fast. When Jonah went to Nineveh, they got right. Now, judgment came later on, but there was a time that there was peace, and there was the blessing of God. Here, Moab is getting destroyed, being destroyed, and there is no rest, there is no repentance. All ye that are about him, bemoan him. And all ye that know his name, say, how is the strong staff broken, and the beautiful rod? Like a little pride in what you look like here. Sound like Satan. Satan's in the midst of Moab. Thou daughter that doeth inhabit Dibon, come down from thy glory. Look how I am, and sit in thirst. No water. For the spoiler of Moab shall come upon thee, and he shall destroy thy strongholds. Destruction again. O heavens of Aor, stand by the way, and espy. Ask him that fleeth, and her that escapeth, and say, what is done? Fleeth, they're running. Escape. You got to escape from somebody in order to escape. You don't escape from nobody. So there's being chased. Moab's confounded, for it is broken down. Howl and cry. Tell ye in Aaron and Moab is spoiled, destroyed. Its goods are gone. And judgment is come upon the plain country, upon Holon, and upon Jahaz, and upon Methan, and upon Dibon, and upon Nebo, and upon Beth Delhaim, upon Kiriathim, and upon Beth Gamon, and upon Beth Meon. All these places are being destroyed. Because they won't worship God. They'll worship their God. And upon Kirioth. That's where Judas. Man of Kirioth. And upon Bozrah. Upon all the cities of the land of Moab, far and near. So it's a vast, great. The horn, in the Bible, the horn is a symbol of power. If you're a goat, and they knew about goats, the goat with the strongest, sharpest, best ability to use his horn would be the winner. And you find that in the illustrations of the visions of Daniel, the he-goat. And he had a horn that fell, and he had another animal with his horn and killed. It's a power. The power of Moab is broken, cast off, put away. His arm is broken. Zechariah 11:16, that's the Antichrist. You've already saw Kirioth. We're stepping into another realm here. Saith the Lord, make ye him drunken. For he magnify himself against the Lord. Who is that? That's Satan. You got Kirioth. You got an arm being broken. You got a horn that's found in Daniel. You got somebody magnifying himself against God. You are now in the realm of Satan. Cursed be he that doeth the work of the Lord deceitfully. What was the work of Satan? To praise God. How is that work become deceitfully? You seen what music, both, I'm going to say Christian, religious realm and that of the earthly realm? Make him drunken, for he magnify himself against the Lord. Moab also shall wallow in his vomit. That don't sound good. Rolling in his puke. The drunken, disordering man. And he shall also be in derision. No state. State of confusion. State of violence. For was not Israel a derision unto thee? Was he found among thieves? For since thou spakest of him, thou skippest for joy. Happy about Israel, not for the good. All ye that dwell in Moab, leave the cities. Get out. And dwell in the rock, fortress. And be like the dove that maketh her nest in the size of the holes of the mouth. A place of a fortress, run to the rock. Or run to the Lord Jesus Christ today. Oh, God told Moses, I'll put you in a cleft of a rock to protect you. We have heard the pride of Moab. Oh, there we go. He is exceedingly proud. Look at the brackets on that one. Who's that run to? Who's the king of all the children of pride? Satan. His loftiness. His arrogancy. And his pride. That's twice pride. Not only has he got the pride being hurt, but it's just pride and haughtiness of his heart. There's the sin of Satan. I know his wrath, saith the Lord. You know, Satan has a wrath. But it shall not be so. His lies, John 8:44, shall not so affect it. Therefore will I howl for Moab, and I will cry out for all Moab. My heart shall mourn for the men of Kirjath. O vine of Sibmah, I will weep for thee with the weeping of Jazer. And thy plants are gone over the sea. They reach even to the sea of Jazer. The spoiler is fallen upon thy summer fruit, upon thy vintage. You know, I can assume that maybe what he's talking about, the people of Moab have been carried away to another place and planted. We see that with Israel. God says, I've chosen you a choice vine, I plucked you, and I put you in the ground and plant, and you became not what I wanted. You became sour grapes. And the Bible will liken men and people and nations to plants. And joy and gladness is taken from the plentiful field. Well, the fields are going to be left empty. No food. From the land of Moab, and I have caused wine to fail from the wine presses. No grapes. The only way you can get wine to fail is you got no crops. Maybe no people. None shall tread with shouting. And that would be a joyful time when they would put the grapes into the wine presses. Be a time of song, time of rejoicing. The harvest has come. Their shouting shall be no shouting. No joy. No entertainment. No refreshing of crops. For the cry of Heshbon, even unto Elah, even unto Jahaz, have they uttered their voice from Zoar. You recognize that one? Even unto Hanaram, as a heifer of 3 years old. Now we're going to start, I think we talked about this in 47, not 46. Here's his young heifer. It can be used. It's healthy. For the waters also of Nimrim shall be desolate. Moreover, I will cause to cease in Moab, saith the Lord, him that offereth in high places. Now here we go. Now we're going to get into the false god worship, and look what happens that we've already studied. We're only going to back up what we've already studied with the Philistines. Now the Philistines and the Moabites are complete two different nations separated by, I'm going to say Israel, I'm talking about the whole land of Israel, separates Moab from Philistines. But watch the God worship that we've already studied. They're in high places. That's exactly where Israel was, in Judah. Him that burneth incense into his gods. That's exactly where Judah was. That's exactly where Israel was. Israel has picked up the fallen worship of the nations around them. Therefore, my heart shall sound for Moab like pipes. My heart shall sound like pipes for the men of Kirjath, because the riches that he has gotten are perished. Everything lost. Why? Because you're worshiping false gods. Everything will be lost when a man is cast in the lake of fire. For every head shall be, what do we read in chapter 47? You know what I also noticed by the Bible, that when Joseph was to go before Pharaoh, I believe it records that he had to shave himself. Pharaoh is a God king, King God, an imitation of the Lord Jesus Christ. You do know that. Because Jesus is God and he's king. Jesus is the original, ultimate God king. But as far as this worship here with the false gods and all that, you would come before them bald. You shave yourself for the gods. And every beard clipped, trimming. And all had to do with false worship. Upon all the hands shall be cuttings. There's cutting yourself. Now, everyone that makes himself bald, I mean, is he worshiping? No, he's not. But look where the foundation comes from. Not a person in his right mind would cut himself for no reason. Unless he's got a chemical imbalance, and I say this reverently, unless they got a mental condition, is unable to comprehend what he's doing, but there is no mental condition here. They're doing it for the sake of worshiping God. There was a guy that was in the tombstones of the graveyard cutting himself. Until Jesus made him right. Made him in his right mind. There are people who are over in the East now. Probably today. Or whenever the day comes. They walk and kneel upon glass and upon stairs for the do the payment of their own sins, which has already been paid. And they're not mentally challenged. They are in their right mind. They are just serving their God. Listen, somebody, I'm trying to say this reverently. I'm not trying to be critical. Somebody who's got a mental disorder, mentally challenged, has no idea what they're doing. They have no capability to comprehend what they're doing as their act. That's an imbalance. There are children and adults out there who are challenged, incapable, and they are so. Whether by birth or by accident, something happened to them in their life. I'm trying to exclude them. I'm not trying to put no darkness upon them. I'm not trying to reprove them. I'm trying to prove that here is somebody that knowingly doing something to harm their body. So what's the first thing that somebody will think about when they try to commit suicide? They'll slash their wrists. And there are people, they can show you the scars. I've seen them. Well, they didn't do it to God. They didn't seek God. But there are people today in this world, 2015, right now, that are causing themselves to bleed, to be cut, pouring out blood for the sole purpose of their sins to be cleansed by their God. And it's what you see in BC 600. It's nothing new. Your hands shall be cuttings. Hands. Suicide. And upon the loins, sackcloth. Yeah, there's that sackcloth. Oh, woe is me. Trouble. Despair. Listen, Nineveh put sackcloth on the animals and the people to show their to God of the heaven of that Jonah preached, we repent. These people are putting the sackcloth on for fallen gods. There shall be lamentation generally upon all the housetops of Moab, place of false worship. Look into the skies, reading the stars, and in the streets thereof, just like Jerusalem. They were worshiping false gods in the streets of Jerusalem, in the temple where the Lord's name was to be. For I have broken Moab like a vessel wherein is no pleasure. I don't want this vessel. I don't get smash it. Saith the Lord. They shall howl. What normal person do you know that howls? You gotta be in a lot of anguish or pain to be howling. The wolfman, I would think, would howl. Being possessed by a spirit that's not of God. How is it broken down? How has Moab turned the back with shame? Turn around. Can't face. So shall Moab be in derision, and a dismay unto all them about him. For thus saith the Lord, Behold, he shall fly as an eagle. Now an eagle will soar. An eagle has great speed when he sees dinner. An eagle can fly higher than any man can go without instruments. I mean, the highest man can go without metal, without fuel, is the top of a mountain. That's it. And he can jump, but that's the highest he can get. An eagle can fly higher than that. An eagle can just take his wings, do what he does with, and just summer around. Behold, he shall fly as an eagle and shall spread his wings over Moab. It's like the Lord's going to take care of Moab after he passes judgment upon it. Kerioth, that name again, is taken, and the strongholds are surprised. They didn't know attack was coming. Only surprise it will be is when the entire earth is gone dark and here comes the light at the end of the tunnel. To be surprised to realize who that one is really coming. And the mighty men's hearts of Moab at that day shall be as the heart of a woman in her pangs. A woman giving birth, labor pains, trouble, anguish, desire to be relieved. And Moab shall be destroyed from being a people because he has magnified himself against the Lord. Now, who done that? So when you go back to verse 40, for thus saith the Lord, Behold, he shall fly as an eagle and spread his wings over Moab. That's not for good. When you take it with verse 42. And when you take it to the Antichrist, I'm telling you, you don't need to worry about Satan. Once the judgment seat of Christ comes, and he's given the 7 years, and then the Lord Jesus Christ comes, and he's locked up for 1,000 years while Christ reigns on this earth, and when Satan is loose, he's got a little bit of a very short time. He is cast into the lake of fire, and you never need to worry about him no more. Fear in the pit, and the snare shall be upon thee, O inhabitant of Moab, saith the Lord. For he that flees from the fear shall fall into the pit. It's a big hole for an animal. A lion. I don't know if they use it for bears. I've heard a bear trap. I know they'll use a pit for a lion. And he that getteth up out of the pit shall be taken in a snare. Bear trap. You know where I'm going with these animals, don't you? For I will bring upon it, even upon Moab, the year of their visitation, saith the Lord. That's not the visitation you want from God. That's not God coming over, sitting down, having a meal with you. They that fled stood under the shadow of Hezbon because of the force. Force be with you. He speaks of the Antichrist, the God of forces. But a fire shall come forth out of Heshbon, and a flame from the midst of Shihon, and shall devour the corner of Moab, and the crown of the head. Have you gone back to Zechariah 11:16 about his eye? You gone to Genesis 3:15 about the heel and about the head? Woe be unto thee, O Moab, that's a woe, to the people of Chemosh perisheth. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes shall not perish. There's no belief in what God... Listen, Moab, and I know Jesus Christ hasn't been born. I understand that. Moab just has to march over the border of Israel, go into Jerusalem and say, hey, there's the temple of the holy God. Show me to a Levite. Levite, what must I do to be right with your God? That's all they need to do. Can you name me one Moab person that did that? Ruth. And look what she got. She became the great, 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 and keep on going, grandmother of the Lord Jesus Christ. So Ruth showed Moab, you can come over and get right with God. But they never did. You know, preach you to go in all the world and preach the gospel. That's what the Jews were supposed to do, you know. They were, when Jesus said, you're the light on a hill, that's not really the church. That was the Jews in Jerusalem with that temple that was built for God, by God, to say to all the world, this is God. And there's only one way to him. It's through Jerusalem. It's through the Jew. It's through the priest. It's through the law. And who ruined that? The Jews. They took on the worship and the foulness of the nations around them, whereas the nations around them were supposed to give up the foulness, give up the worship of false gods, and turn to the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Now that God has destroyed Judah and Jerusalem, his people, the beacon, the light, now he's going to all these nations and say, hey, now you're without excuse. Don't you know that the judgment shall begin at the house of God first? Listen, all that God had done for the Jew in Exodus, it's worldwide known. It's in the history books. When they reached Jericho, Rahab said, we have heard of it. It was already known. When they came into the land, I forget which group of people came to Joshua dressed up in Halloween costume, saying, and what they're saying is, we fear your God, please help us. It was known worldwide. The Babylonian guy comes up to Jeremiah and says, your God has caused this. God was new in Babylon. Nebuchadnezzar got to meet God. They're without excuse. For thy sons are taken captives, and thy daughters captives. Exactly what happened to Judah. Exactly what happened to Jeremiah. Listen, it's going to happen to you if it happened to my people. If God doesn't take these nations to do the same thing he done to his Jews, to his people, to Israel, the descendants of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, God would have to call every one of them that's in the other guy questioned me last night. You mean Jews are in hell? I said, yes. Those who are without Christ, those who have not obeyed the law in the time before Christ, they are in hell. God would have to call those Jews up and apologize to them, and it's not going to happen. You know what God did to Judah and Jerusalem was be a sign to all the nations around. You better get right. You know what? Why Hitler and Germany is still on the tongues of America today? Because you better not do what they did to the Jews. You know why we are showing England what they did to the Jews as history? Because you better be careful, because I will judge you as I did with those nations, and such as I've done with Russia. That's why they're rewriting the history book, so we can get rid of what God has done, so we can do what we want to do, and God will not touch us because we rewrite history. See, we can eliminate the foundation of America as a Christian nation. Then we can do whatever we want to do. It's not going to happen. Yet will I bring again the captivity of Moab in the latter days. So there is hope, saith the Lord. Thus far is the judgment of Moab. Until then, judgment upon desolation, war, slaughter, captivity. All because Abraham prayed for Lot. That's the only reason why Lot was spared. You do know that. Because Abraham said, you know, he started with 50. Lord, if they put 30, no, I won't do it for the Lord. If they're, when it got down to 10, Lord said, you know, I know there's at least one righteous man in there. And I'll take that one righteous man out. But I got to destroy the city, Abraham. And that's why he went as far as down to 10. You gotta realize, if God is going to judge his people, and he's going to, I am a child of God by the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, and yet I'm a sinner. There are going to be some sins at the judgment seat of Christ that will be there, and I'm going to have to face the judgment. I'm going to have to pay the penalty of a loss. Now, if I'm going to lose things at the judgment seat of Christ, it better be well sure of that at the great white throne judgment, these people don't did anything that God told them to do, outside of not even believing the Lord Jesus Christ as their Savior. I expect judgment upon them. That's a righteous and holy God. He knows who gets judged first. The Christians. I'm talking about the Bible-believing, born-again, blood-bought, washed in the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. The finished shed, we are judged before all. I believe right at the point of the rapture, I believe we are judged at that point. Some people say we're judged when we die. Okay. But for surety, judgment will happen at the rapture. We can't go to heaven with our sins upon us. God will not let us into heaven with our sins. We've got to be judged before we go to heaven. And then what is the next great big judgment? The nations. But if you want to skip that one, you want to go to what the next big great judgment, the great white throne judgment. All these nations. But the people of God are judged first. And as we're judged, as we suffer loss, as we, so are the people that are expected who didn't obey God at all. And then when they cry foul, hey, listen, those are my people over there. He lost something. That one has no crowns at all. That one lost a couple crowns. If I judged them and I took away from them, you don't think I'm going to do it to you? That's the righteousness of justice of God.